Welcome to Lantern's Insight, where we take Magic the Gathering's long lore, break it down, and dramatically retell it back to you. All characters and art are owned by Magic the Gathering, Wizards of the Coast, and Hasbro. If you want to learn more about Magic the Gathering the game, please visit the links down below. Did you know that Sorin's magic literally makes you rot? If you didn't, well, you better buckle in, because this week on Know Your Planeswalker, our spotlight is going to be Sorin, Lord of Innistrad. Who is Sorin Markov? Well, to answer that question, let's dive into the history of the nobleman. Sorin wasn't always a vampire, but he was always part of a royal family. When he was a child, he lived with his grandfather, Edgar Markov. Edgar was a nobleman, like a duke or something similar to that, on Innistrad. But this Innistrad was nothing like what we see today at the start of Shadows of Innistrad, or even a year earlier at the start of the original block. This was over 2,500 years ago. Back then, there were a lot of premortal sort of evils out there, and those evils were mysterious and unknown. Giant sea monsters or trees coming to life and stealing children. There was no church, and there was no protection for the weak humans. One of the evils that manifested in Edgar's lands of Stencia was a famine. It's not very clear what kind of blight caused this famine, other than it was wholly unnatural. But Edgar saved the day when he contacted the demon Shilgengar, the demon that likely caused the blight in the first place, and he created a ritual infused with dark alchemy and demonic magic to create the first of two vampires, himself and Sorin. This ritual was painful and traumatic and ignited Sorin's latent spark, and there you go, Sorin has a spark. A side note on sparks, things without souls can't have sparks, so beings of pure mana like angels and demons don't get them, or dead things, which normally occurs with undead vampires and zombies. Sorin having a demon ritual lets him sort of bypass this rules, since he's not technically dead, just demonic. Creative liberties. From here, Sorin saw the humans spared of having to die from famine. Instead, they ended up having to die from vampires as he and his extended families consumed them as food sources. And as he got older, he still felt something for these small people. He tried burying in a life living by his whims and doing whatever he wanted, until his emotions became dulled and more numb. During this time, Sorin traveled to a lot of planes, met a lot of people, and got himself involved with a lot of things. I'd love to go into details about what these things were, but the creative team has been purposefully vague about these events, likely so they can throw Sorin into an event with the excuse, oh yeah, he was there once. Regardless, we do know one of these events that he got involved with, and that was with the Eldrazi. We know he was fighting these titans shortly after his ascension, and at least before the Mending, a time before when planeswalkers had more or less the power of gods, and that's when he met Nahiri, a core lithomancer walker from Zenthikar. His reasoning for fighting these titans was to keep his plane safe by defeating them before they were able to come to his world. By this point, he already knew Ugin, as it was one of the few planeswalkers that was older than him, and the three of them used Zenthikar as a lure and prison for the titans. Sorin's magic was used specifically to weaken the three enough just to be locked away. After making a deal to come back and check on the plane every so often, and fight the titans should they ever get close to escaping, he went back to home to Innistrad. There he saw humanity, his family's food source mind you, was mostly extinct. He used all the powers he knew from his long life and his extensive plane hopping to create the Angel Avacyn. This would mark the return of humanity. Then the Mending would happen. That was sort of a multiverse-wide nerf on Planeswalkers' powers, turning most of them simply into just more powerful mages than normal rather than gods. Sorin was depowered in this as well, but luckily still immortal due to his vampire curse and still retained all of his previous knowledge. Sorin would disappear for a long time after this, but we would see him next visiting Zenthikar, keeping up with his promise. He saw that the lock was loosened on the Titan's cage since Jace and Chandra were tricked into a fight with Sarkon in the Eye of Ugin, so it was up to him to fix this lock. Meeting up with Nissa, a xenophobic elf who hated all things vampire, she helps guide him to the Eye in the story Teeth of a Coon, which I'll recount in a different video. In the end, Nissa finds out that Sorin is in fact not just a planeswalker, but also a vampire who may have started the vampire race on Zenthikar. There's no confirmation in this, it's just heavily hinted. Vampires are native to Zenthikar, and they have legends about a propagator who looks exactly like Sorin. Sorin actually has a habit of making vampires to guide him to places no matter where he is, because he's a huge jerk who doesn't like to ask for directions. So it's no wonder that Nyssa does the exact opposite of what Sorin says and frees the Eldrazi instead of helping keep them locked up. At this point, Sorin literally says, "I told you so," mocks washing his hands of the situation, and Planes walks away. But turns out Sorin's not that bad of a guy, and he walks to Takir to let Ugin know about the situation. Here we have two different things that happen. In the Khan's non-timeline changed world, he makes a vampire guide out of a Tamir warrior and finds Ugin's dead body. In the new timeline, he makes a vampire guide out of an Atarkin warrior and wakes up Ugin from his Hedron cocoon nap to tell him what happened to the Eldrazi. Ugin then scolds him and tells him to go find Nahiri, literally saying, "I don't want to see your face until hers is with you," so that they can deal with this. And he would find her later, but not the way he wanted to. But that's a video for another time. Looking at what Sorin's capable of, you have to divide this into two camps, pre-mending and post-mending. Pre-mending, Sorin could do anything he could now and more. He made a virtual god of an entire plane, strong enough to power up a whole civilization to battle back from the brink of death to create a lasting society, nay, even victorious currently. And on top of all that, he was able to waken all three titans at once with his Sengromancy. But after the mending, he lost a lot of power in his spells. They lacked a certain oomph. Still, he could make some constructs, not nearly the same way as Avacyn. And he could still control people's life forces, but not nearly as powerful, and Planeswalkers can now resist the rotting effects more easily. But he still has a strong ability in forceful mind control, and retains every power that the Vampires of Innistrad has. This includes, but isn't limited to, incredible sword fighting knowledge, the ability to make new vampires, being about two times as strong as a normal person. He also has agelessness, doesn't need to breathe or be warm to live, and unknown to most people, he has about a 3-foot wide aura around him at all points and times that dampens sounds into silence. This can make him a very stealthy killer. On the side of weaknesses, he can still die to most things that could kill someone. He has a need to feed that, when unstated, will make him enraged. And he doesn't cast a shadow or a reflection naturally, and has weakness to organic things that grow like wood. If you needed a mental edge against the vampire, anything that could threaten his homeworld of Innistrad will put the walker on tilt. So while Sorin is a Hendoistic person, as black is the color of greed, he also has a hint of white, as he generally does care for others. His greatest care is that over Innistrad, his homeworld, which he even went so far as to creating a god to protect vampires from killing off their food source and earned him the scorn of his people. He's even made grudging promises to other planes, agreeing to help them, usually for something in return, though. This likely stems back to when he was a human, as he didn't grow up a vampire. He was a child who endured the harsh evils of his world and watched a blight make most of the population, to which he was a nobleman, go starving. While the thousands of years have certainly numbed these emotions, they're still there, much to Sorin's dismay. While Sorin isn't a particular fan of his humanity, this is where readers can actually relate to him, and is the strongest quality, in my opinion, of his character. He doesn't want to help, but he needs to. It's the same feeling that you might get when you see a dog out on the side of the road, lost from home. You don't want to help, you might even be scared to become attached to it, but there's still something deep down inside you that tells you it's the right thing to do. In many ways, this is all Sorin has left in his long life. It's the last scrap of him that hasn't vanished over time. I hope you all enjoyed learning about Sorin's past and who he is. If you want to hear more about Magic's long lore, tap that subscribe button down below. If you want to start a discussion, feel free to comment. If you'd like to follow me on Twitter, you can always do so at LanternMTG. Do me a favor and pick the next walker I should spotlight. Arlen Cord, Jace Bellerin, or Nahiri the Lithomancer. Thanks for watching, guys, and I'll see you next week.